Hachette Audio presents October Surprise, How the FBI Tried to Save Itself and Crashed an Election. Written by Devlin Barrett. Read by John Bedford Lloyd. To my wife, Miranda, and to my late mother, Blair Gibb, co-author of When Good Companies Do Bad Things. Never let your sense of morals get in the way of doing what's right. Isaac Asimov. Can't fix stupid. Shu. Part 1. Fidelity. 1. Missile fire. Friday, July 6th, 2012. Of all the elements of the 2016 election that made Donald Trump president, the most surprising and hotly debated to this day was the role of the FBI. The combination of presidential politics, classified intelligence, and bureaucratic backbiting combined to inject a toxic level of anger and distrust into the body politic and the highest levels of the world's premier law enforcement agency. The debate over why Trump won, why Hillary Clinton lost, and how much of that result was due to the FBI has never really ended. Even in 2020, the political schism of those questions often seems as fresh as it was on Election Day, with us all trapped in a kind of feedback loop of recriminations over Clinton's emails, Russia, and Trump. As part of that feedback loop, I found myself in the extremely odd and uncomfortable situation of becoming a player in some of the key events in October 2016, which led to one of the FBI's top officials nearly being indicted over my reporting. But as Republicans and Democrats fought over the FBI in the following years, it seemed the true lessons of that tumultuous election year grew further away rather than closer. In 2016, the FBI, an agency whose motto is fidelity, bravery, integrity, and which has long held itself out to the public as above reproach and above politics, proved just how susceptible it was to the same anger, mistrust, and misunderstanding that plagued the political process. There were many ingredients that combined to make 2016 an election like no other. But to understand just how decisive a role the FBI played in American politics, one has to look back further in time to see the forces that were building, not just inside the FBI and the Justice Department, two organizations whose inner workings are closely guarded secrets shrouded from public view, but also inside Congress and the American electorate. Many of the events of 2016 were difficult, if not impossible, to predict. This book is an attempt, after years of partisan spin and bureaucratic bluster, to help people at least understand what did and didn't happen in 2016 inside the FBI, and, most importantly, why things turned out the way they did. Strange as it may seem, that story begins years ago on the other side of the world, in a remote town in northern Pakistan called Zawi Siji. As the sun began to set on July 6, 2012, a number of men in the village gathered to eat dinner under a tent. Some residents noticed drones circling above them in the sky. Suddenly, they heard the sound of missiles rushing toward them. The missiles struck the tent, creating an explosion of gases moving at thousands of feet per second. The force of the blast killed at least 8 people, witnesses said. Neighbors rushed to help and found a blast site littered with severed body parts. The people tried to collect their bodies. Some were carrying stretchers, blankets, and water, a witness, Junaid, would later tell an investigator with the human rights group Amnesty International. Witnesses said minutes after the first attack, while people scrambled to help the injured and the dead, the drones fired a second volley at the site, killing some of those responding to help. At least 6 people died in the second strike. The final death toll would rise to 18, including, according to witnesses, a 14-year-old boy named Saleh Khan, who sold wood in the town. More than 20 others were wounded. The bodies were burnt, and it was not possible to recognize them, said Nabil, another villager. In the big picture of the Obama administration's war on terror, the missile strike was fairly routine. Zawi Siji was in the Waziristan region bordering Afghanistan. To terror networks like the Taliban, crossing the Afghanistan-Pakistan border was an essential part of their strategy to strike in Afghanistan, then slip back over the border to safety in Pakistan. To counter that tactic, the Obama administration had adopted and expanded a program known as signature strikes. Missiles were fired from CIA drones even when U.S. counterterrorism officials did not know the identities of the people they were killing. Instead, analysts working with classified information gathered evidence about the types of activity they observed, their signatures, to be confident the target was a terrorist hotspot. U.S. intelligence had concluded the tent at Zawi Siji was a meeting point for militants. In the moral calculus of the U.S. drone program, that made it an acceptable target. Due to the inaccessibility and danger for Westerners to travel to such areas, it was often hard for the rest of the world to learn the details about drone strikes, which is why most of the available information about what happened that day comes from Amnesty International. Villagers told the human rights group that those killed were not Taliban fighters, but farmers and miners. Counterterrorism officials were confident in the accuracy of their intelligence. Within hours, news agencies issued the first public reports about the drone strike. U.S. drone strike kills 4 militants in Pakistan, the first Associated Press headline read. Dateline from Pakistan's capital, Islamabad. The story began, Pakistani intelligence officials say missiles fired by a U.S. drone have killed at least 4 suspected militants near the Afghan border. The U.S. government kept the drone strike program highly classified. Even using the word drone was considered a serious violation of the classification rules. Senior staff of the U.S. Embassy in Islamabad were closely involved in the CIA's drone strikes. Such remote-controlled missile strikes were deeply unpopular in Pakistan. And in order to try to manage the diplomatic and political aftershocks of such strikes, the senior State Department official in the country, either the ambassador or whoever was acting in his or her stead when they were away, had to give the okay. The U.S. Embassy also was under strict orders to keep their superiors at the State Department in Washington, D.C., up to date at all times on developments that could affect their relationships with the governments of Pakistan and Afghanistan. The July 6th strike was particularly important to the State Department because just 3 days earlier, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton had issued an apology while carefully avoiding using what her advisors referred to as the A word to the government of Pakistan for a 2011 airstrike that killed 24 Pakistani soldiers. The Pakistan government was so angry about the attack that they cut off critical supply lines used by the U.S. and its allies to supply soldiers in Afghanistan. This created a logistical nightmare for NATO forces that added more than $1 billion to the shipping and transportation costs of the decade-long military conflict. The bombing of the Pakistan military site put the relationship into a deep freeze that lasted 6 months, until a delicate conversation between Clinton and Pakistan's Foreign Minister, Hina Rabbani Kaur, finally got the supply line reopened. We are sorry for the losses suffered by the Pakistani military, Clinton said after her call with Carr. We are committed to working closely with Pakistan and Afghanistan to prevent this from ever happening again. Even after the impasse was over, the State Department was still highly sensitive to other drone strikes or developments that might derail the delicate alliance. Further complicating matters, in a matter of days, Clinton was due to meet Carr again at a global summit on Afghanistan's future. If a new assault just over the border was going to affect the meeting, Clinton's people wanted to know about it as soon as possible. So a flurry of communications ensued, mostly by email. At the time of that particular strike, the U.S. ambassador to Pakistan, Cameron Munter, was in the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.